Welcome, friends. Welcome back to the kitchen. Welcome back to Sunday morning and the old cookbook show. Today we're going to do a recipe out of the oldest cookbook that I own, and that's this one. This is the Acompliśht Cook, written by a guy named Robert May, and this was first published in 1660 in England. I have a fifth edition copy, published in 1685, and my copy is in not so great condition. It has been rebound. The end boards are original, but the spine is brand new. And there were a couple of pages missing in the middle, and whoever rebound it replaced those pages, but made it very obvious that they're replacement pages, so you're not trying to fool anybody. And the pages that were missing from this book were probably the most interesting ones in the entire book, which is why they were missing. They are the ones with drawings of how to decorate your pies. So this was this one published in 1685. This guy Robert May was born in 1588, and so by the time this was first published, he was quite old. There's some discussion about whether he was actually born in 1588 and when he died. He would have been in his 90s when this book was published. The fifth edition was published. And even though many accounts say that Robert May died much earlier than this printing, you can see that he has dated the foreword, or written the foreword, in 1684, about a year before this fifth edition was printed. So he may have been alive, he may not have been alive, we just don't know. Beyond that, we don't really know much about him other than what is written in the front of the book, and that is that he was born into a family that was in service in the great manor houses. His father was a chef, and at 10 years old, the lady of the manor house sent him to Paris to learn how to be a chef. And so he spent a number of years in France learning the art of French cooking, came back to England, worked in professional kitchens throughout England, and then came back to the manor house where he was born and his parents had worked, and served there as the chef. And so a lot of these recipes really reflect that trajectory. They are written in a manner that isn't for the home cook. Most of the recipes are for very large quantities for banquets and very expensive banquets. And the recipes are also written in a way that it assumes you've had years of professional kitchen training. The vast majority of recipes don't give any method or description of how you're supposed to make the dish. And most of them only list the amount for one ingredient, and then you're supposed to know the rest of the ingredients, how they all fit together. The recipe that we're doing today is called To Make Rice Pudding in Guts. And I chose this one because it has ingredients that we mostly have access to today. You'll notice one recipe prior to this is also for a rice pudding, but it contains ambergris. And if you don't know what ambergris is, you might not want to know what ambergris is. But it's not common as a food ingredient today. It's mostly used in perfume. So I've chosen this one because he does give amounts, and he does give a bit of a method. And I thought it would be a way to ease ourselves into this cookbook. And then from here, we'll move on and try some other ones. So to start off with the rice pudding, I have put in this pot, as he instructs, rice and milk. And so the instructions for this are to make rice puddings in guts. Boil half a pound of rice with 3 pints of milk and a little beaten mace. Boil it until the rice be dry, but never stir it. And if you do, you must stir it continually or else it will burn. And you'll notice from this that this is written in a style that's often called early modern English or late middle English. It's kind of in a midpoint between those two types of English. In that it uses the long S. So everywhere that you, almost everywhere that you see an F, or what would appear to be an F, it's actually an S. And other places where you would expect to see a long S, you see an actual S. So it's in a transition. So I'm going to got this on. I'm going to bring it to a simmer, not to a full boil, just to a simmer, and we're going to boil it until the rice be dry. I almost forgot, I'm supposed to cast in a little beaten mace. So there we go, some mace. Now this is the oldest cookbook that I have in my collection. I don't bring it out that often because it is exceedingly rare. Some estimates peg that between all five editions published in the 1600s, there were fewer than 200 books published or printed, and some estimates put it as high as 400 books published or printed in that time period. Either way, that's not a whole lot of books, and there's not very many of them that have survived to 2021. I don't know how many are in private hands. I haven't been able to find that information out. I do know that there are institutions that have them in their libraries. I don't really worry about it that much. I just think of myself as a shepherd of these books. They're mine for a little while, and when I'm done with them, I'm going to pass them along to a university research library that collects old cookbooks, because they are a fantastic way to look at a snapshot of a certain part of life in a very certain period of time. And this gives a snapshot of high society life in 1685. People going to country manor houses in England and eating extravagant meals. Okay, so I gave in and started stirring because it was sticking and burning regardless of the instructions. And as much as the instructions say to boil it until the rice be dry, this rice is never going to dry out. It's turning into sort of a goopy mess, which I would expect from boiling rice in milk, especially boiling rice in that amount of milk. There's no indication what kind of rice Robert May would be referring to in 1685, or even 1660, if this is in the earlier editions. We do know that rice arrived in Europe and England in about the 1100s. So the instructions are that I'm supposed to put it in here and let any of the liquid run out. Absolutely no liquid is going to run out of here, which tells me that whatever variety of rice he was using in the 1600s is completely different from what I have here today. So I'm going to turn this in and we're going to move on with the next ingredients. And if you haven't noticed, I'm only making half of the recipe. So calls for 6 eggs in the original recipe, 3 eggs, whole eggs, and 3 egg yolks. So I'm only going to put in 3 eggs. I'm going to use 2 whole eggs and 1 egg yolk. And so I'll start that off with a bit of a stir, just to break the eggs in, get them into the rice a little bit. Next, he calls for sugar, an unspecified amount of salt, unspecified amount of cinnamon, and an unspecified amount of nutmeg. Okay, now this also gets currants, beef-ḫeut. You can't have a pudding without beef-ḫeut, and some rose water. So a lot of recipes in this book, in this time period, feature rose water, and copious amounts of rose water. So in that goes. I'm going to mix this all together. Now, I cut back on the amount of rose water in fear that rose water today might be a little bit more powerful than it was then, because it seems to be what everybody says. It is overpoweringly rose watery. Now, this next section I had to look up. I wanted to make sure that I got it right. The instruction is, then dry the small guts of a hog, sheep, or beaver, and being finely cleaned for the purpose, steep and fill them. Cut the guts a foot long and fill them 3/4 full. Tie both ends together and put them in boiling water. So the word dry is what kind of threw me. And through calling some people and asking some questions of food historians, they said that any way that I was going to get guts today would have been through that process. So all I had to do was treat them as I would if I was making sausage. So what I had in my fridge are beef bungs. And in this bowl is a beef bung that I have washed and rinsed and soaked and cleaned completely. We're ready to go with filling. And I'm not really sure how I'm going to fill this. I've got a little thing that I would use for on the sausage stuffer for stuffing it, but getting it into the beef bung might be an interesting process. Let's see how it goes. Okay, beef bung. And they're really pliable. Has pretty much no smell at this point because it's been really soaked and cleaned. So I'm going to put the nozzle in and let's see. A little bit messy, A little bit messy. We'll get there. I am sure that the person stuffing hog casings and beef bungs with rice pudding in the kitchen in the 1600s would have been bottom of the pile. Now, I've got one of these filled, and I think earlier I called this a beef bung. I'm pretty sure this is actually a beef middle. They're slightly different, and I have them in the fridge. They're not labeled, and until I got it full, I wasn't really sure. So, half of this recipe, for those of you who want to know, half of this recipe would probably fill 2.5 or 3 of these. I only got one ready today, so I'm only going to do the one. I'm going to tie it up the way that it's been asked for. I'm going to stick this in a bowl, and I'm going to bake it in a bain-marie in the oven, and we'll taste them both and see if there's anything different. This goes into a pot of boiling water for about 1/4 hour. Oh, yeah.
Hey, Glen.
Hey, Jules.
Fork or spoon for this pudding?
No clue.
All right, I'll bring a little of each.
Okay, so that one gets extra guts.
Okay.
This is, let me read the correct.
Well, it smells all like pudding. I can smell the raisins and the rose.
The name of the recipe is to make rice puddings in guts.
Okay, then this is how you do it. So you boiled it?
Yeah,
so
you...
So it's like a sous vide?
It is like sous vide. It is... It is,
it is the original sous vide?
It is a 1685 version of sous vide. Okay.
Okay, so I picked the spoon. Did you pick a spoon?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, I'm having a hard time with the outer casing, so maybe that's not supposed to be consumed.
You might not eat the outer casing.
No. Well, because, I mean, in sausages you sometimes do, right?
Yeah.
But I'm having a hard time with it. It's got the texture of rice pudding. It's rice pudding.
It's rice pudding.
With rose water.
The rose water is overpowering for me, and I even cut some of the rose water back. I think I could probably cut it back even more, and it would be more pleasant to me. I'm not a huge fan of rose water.
Is there vanilla in it?
There's no vanilla in
so
it.
So that's where you would put the flavors that you like in a pudding, right?
Like yes.
Maybe, I don't know. Maybe some bourbon.
That would be really good. The rice pudding recipe before this one in the book flavored it with ambergris.
Okay. That's got to be hard to get hold of.
Mm.
Now, maybe not so much then.
Found a guy in South Africa who will sell me 1 gram of ambergris for 40 British pounds. What's that, 80 bucks Canadian?
I don't know. How much
for a gram of ambergris? And plus postage.
Okay. So we may not be doing the ambergris version. Now, I'm fascinated because, of course, you said you had leftovers, and this one is not, like, it has a slightly more caramely color to it.
And when it came out of the oven, it looked horrible because all of that beef suet had bubbled up and there was like a layer of oil on top. But it's now sucked back in.
I don't really notice. In either of them, I don't really notice.
No.
And I imagine in this era, that fat was a super important part of the caloric intake.
You needed the fat.
I'm good.
I like it better in the guts than in the pot. I thought I'd like the caramely because it's baked and it's more caramely.
There you go. I like the one in the pot, but I think I like the caramely. So I don't think it matters which way you do it. It's a decent rice pudding recipe.
So a 1685 rice pudding recipe cooked sous vide in a beef bung. Thanks for stopping by. See you again soon.